Thank you for a nice introduction, and I also want to thank the organizers for inviting me here. I actually haven't worked much in elbows problems, but a little bit. So the outline of my talk is the following. First, I set up the problem. Then I tell about the projection methods for solving this. And I talk about self-regularization, so I want to choose the dimension of the projection space independence of my noise level of the data. I talk a little bit about choice of n by the discrepancy principle and also about modification of the discrepancy principle in cases where the projectors are not uniformly bounded. This is not usually considered, but in some cases, the projectors are not bounded. And some applications and some numerical results. So the problem is set up in Banach spaces. So E and F are Banach spaces. A is linear continuous operator from E to F. And we consider equation AU equals F. F is in the range of A, but it is unknown, and we only know the noisy data, F delta, and the level of the noise is also known. Typically, the problem is originally formulated in infinite dimensional space. And if the problem is elbowed, then usually it is first regularized and then discretized. But often the discretization works also as regularization as well. So if the data are noisy and the noise level is known, then by proper choice of the dimension of the discretization space, the solutions of the discretized equations with noisy data converge to the solution of the original problem with the exact data. And most of the results about self-regularization have been obtained in Hilbert spaces. But for integral equations, actually the most natural space is C, continuous functions. Especially if we want to do collocation methods, then the space F should be C, or maybe sometimes C1. And if we want to use quadrature methods, then we usually want to assume that the solution is at least in C. Also, often L1 is useful if we want to recover sparse solutions, and sometimes also like PV spaces or other spaces are used. Now, projection methods. We assume that the equation 1 is uniquely solvable and U star is a solution for exact F. So this is throughout this talk. We choose some finite dimensional spaces En and Zn. Zn is a subspace of F star, not F as usual. And the dimensions generally should be equal. The general linear projection method looks like this. So for all Zn's in this space, Zn, Zn applied to AUn must be equal to Cn applied to F delta. Now, if we define an operator Qn from F to Zn star as here, then we can write this equation 2 in this form. It looks like the usual writing up of projection methods, but actually this Qn is not a projector. It does not project. It does not work from F to some subspace of F, but to some space Zn star, which can usually be identified by some Rn just. And also the norm of this Qn is always 1. And for example, collocation method for integral equations, then we might want to take for F space of continuous functions. And for the space Zn, we want to take span of delta functions. So actually in this equation here, we may just use for those Cns, those delta functions here, because they are the basis of this space. And then this equation two can be written as follows. Well, just the ordinary form of collocation method. Okay, let us define quantity kn, kappa and tilde as follows. And then we can state uniqueness result of the discrete solution. So if dimensions of En and Zn are equal, and the null space of Q and A intersection with En is just trivial, then this discrete equation two is uniquely solvable for each F delta from F. And if we denote by An operator Q and A considered as acting from En to Zn star, then this lemma means that this An as an inverse, and actually the norm of the inverse is exactly this kappa n tilde. Now there are some other quantities one may want to consider. So this kappa n prime like this. They're quite similar, but not the same. And this was kappa and tilde from the previous slide. And also for discrepancy principle, usually one wants to consider quantity tau n as this. And also things are related as in the following lemma. So if we have the assumptions that dimensions of these spaces are the same and the null space is again trivial, then this kappa n is always less or equal than this kappa n prime. This is less or equal than kappa n tilde. And this is less or equal than tau n times kappa n. If there exists tau less than infinity, such that tau n, all tau n's are less or equal than tau, so it means that those tau n's are actually uniformly bounded, then we also have this kappa n tilde less or equal than tau times kappa n, and it means that all those quantities are actually equivalent, all those kappas are equivalent, so it doesn't really matter which one we use. Now, convergence with a priori choice of n depending on delta. Well, this is, I think, quite standard result. So as you thought, problems one and two are uniquely solvable for each n bigger or equal than some n zero, and u star and u n are their solutions. Then we have the following error estimate. So this thing here. And it can also be estimated like this. Now, if the data are exact, then convergence, un converges to u star as n goes to infinity, it holds if and only if there exists a sequence un hat in en satisfying the convergence conditions that un hat, u star minus un hat goes to zero, and also this thing goes to zero as n goes to infinity. And this is really if and only if condition. Also, if these conditions hold and the data are noisy, then if we choose n depending on delta, so that n delta goes to infinity, and this kappa prime times delta goes to zero as delta goes to zero, then we have the convergence of the approximate solution to our real solution as delta goes to zero. Now, this convergence is like for particular solution u star. And actually this condition can be satisfied in cases where you know something about smoothness of u star. If u star is smoother, then we have better convergence rate of this part here, and then it doesn't make it doesn't matter so much if this thing grows very quickly. So it can be satisfied for smooth data, even if it may not be satisfied if the data is really not smooth. And in some cases, we know something about the regularity of the solution or regularity of the right-hand side of our equation. The next theorem gives conditions for convergence for every f in the range of A. Well, it is quite similar. Again, we assume that 1 and 2 are uniquely solvable. And in case of exact data, the convergence holds for every f if and only if the subspaces En satisfy this condition. So basically, it means that if n goes to infinity, they are dense, they get denser and denser in E. And the projectors, so these things are really projectors from E to En, they are uniformly bounded. Means that this is satisfied for at least starting from some n zero. Also, those last two conditions are necessary and sufficient for existence of relations of n equals n delta, so that we have convergence of the approximate solutions to the real solution u star as delta goes to zero for every f. Now, for convergence analysis in case of exact data, we can choose different image spaces. And we can also choose image space such that the equation becomes well-posed. But if the data is noisy, then the image space is really determined by the data. It is actually determined by what kind of measurement error we have, in what norm we have this condition that f minus f delta norm is less than delta. And the following theorem shows that if we have a convergence for something I call the main part of the equation or somehow like simple part, sometimes it can be separated out in integral equations, then it implies convergence for the whole equation. So if 1 and 2 are uniquely solvable, starting from some n0, and there is a sequence of un hat satisfying that the exact solution, well, this un hat converges to u star. And if the operator A has the form A equals s plus k, where s is invertible, so this s is this main part, somehow simpler part. S is invertible if considered as an operator from E to some W, which is subspace of F. And K, as considered from A to W, is compact. Then if we have convergence for this S, ignoring this part with K, then we also have convergence for our original equation AU equals F. Okay, if we want to consider the influence of noisy data, then we had a factor in front of delta, it was this kappa n prime, and it is essential how this behaves. If we want to estimate those quantities, we actually introduce some kind of artificial operators Pn, which act from Cn star to F, such that this equality here holds. And since the operator Pn times Qn is a projector in F, now we denote by Fn the range of this Pn. And we assume that this range, this Fn, is a subspace of W, the smoother space. And W, and we denote Wn, this Fn, but equipped with a different norm, with a norm of W. And let In be the identity operator considered as acting from Fn to Wn. Then we can estimate this kappa n prime in the following way. It is just the norm of the identity operator acting from this Fn to Wn. And this kind of estimates are often known, especially for spline spaces, but also for other spaces. I want to emphasize here that this choice of this Pn is actually arbitrary. It is not determined by our problem or our equations. For example, if we have collocation methods, since this Qn we had just took function f, and Qnf was just values of f at some fixed points. Since this Pn should be something that takes those values and gets you back some function f, so that the result is in space W. But it can be some kind of interpolation operator, but it doesn't really matter to what we map or how we construct this f. It can be some interpolation with splines, interpolation with polynomials, with trigonometric polynomials. It doesn't really matter. The only condition here is it should be smooth enough so that this Fn is a subspace of W. So it has to be smooth. Smooth enough depending on our problem. Now, choice of n by discrepancy principle. Let these problems 1 and 2 be uniquely solvable. And let this kind of convergence hold. Well, often we can just write kappa n here, but actually in the proof we need this kappa n plus 1 prime. Usually kappa n and kappa n plus 1 are equivalent, but maybe not always, so I put kappa n plus 1 here. We also assume that there exists a sequence of approximation from the space En satisfying that they converge to un star, and this norm here goes to zero. If we assume that there is tau less than infinity, such that those tau n's are all bounded by tau, then if we choose b greater than tau plus 1, and we can fix this p, then for any delta, we can choose n by discrepancy principle as the first index such that this inequality holds. Since this n is finite and the discrete solutions converge to the exact solution as delta goes to zero. Now, I told you before that I don't really want to assume that there exists such a tau, because in some cases, those tau n's are not bounded uniformly. And as the next, well, it is not satisfied, for example, if we want to interpolate with polynomials, and we use space C or some CM. And for this case, I have the following theorem. So I assume that all assumptions of the previous theorems are satisfied, but not with this uniform boundedness. So I skip this one. Now I can't choose a fixed p. This p must depend on n, and it depends on tau n. And it must be such that it is greater than 1 plus tau n times 1 plus epsilon with some fixed positive epsilon. So it is not enough just to choose p n bigger than 1 plus tau n. It has to be somehow uniformly bigger in this sense that it is multiplied by this 1 plus tau n is multiplied by something fixed, which is bigger than 1. Then again, if we choose n by discrepancy principle, so that this condition is satisfied, then this n is finite, and the approximate solutions converge to the exact solution as delta goes to 0. Okay, some examples. I have been working with cordial integral equations recently, well, mostly of second kind, but I also considered integral equations of first kind. And cordial integral equations are integral equations of this kind. Here, this phi is called the core of the cordial integral operator. A and f are just given smooth enough functions. I define the following operators. So v phi is just if this a is constantly equal to 1, and v phi a is the same operator here. And you may note that there is this kind of singularity 1 over t here. This actually changes quite a bit properties of the integral equation. There is also a different form of this cordial integral equation. If we make a change of variables, s equals t times x, and we denote by p t of x, a at t and tx, then this operator actually changes into this form. So cordial integral operator can also be written in this form. It is not quite equivalent, but more or less. Some properties of those cordial integral operators. First, if this phi is in L1 and A is in Cm, m is something fixed, it can be also zero. Then this operator is linear continuous operator in Cm, and its norm can be estimated as here. Now, if phi is in L1 and lambda is some complex number with positive real part, then t to lambda is an eigenfunction of this v phi. So this was the operator when a was constantly 1. And the corresponding eigenvalue is given by this formula. And if this real part is bigger than m, then this eigenfunction also belongs to Cm. And it actually means that this operator cannot be compact. It is never compact because it has too many eigenfunctions. It has an uncountable set of eigenfunctions. If we have this coefficient a also present, then we can again describe exactly the spectrum of the operator in Cm, and it is given by this formula. It is 0, and a at 0, 0 times those phi k hat, which were defined here. They actually don't depend on A at all, only phi. And then this is for k from 0 to m. And then A 0, 0 times this phi hat at lambda with all lambdas with real parts bigger or equal than m. So this spectrum actually typically behaves like this. So if we have the spectrum, say, in space of continuous functions, something like this, then if we take some higher m's, then the spectrum gets smaller, maybe something like this. And there are some values here which remain outside. These are those phi hat k, k from 0 to m. And this operator is actually compact if and only if this a at 0, 0 is equal 0. Okay. Existence and uniqueness of solutions of first kind cordial integral equation. There is the following theorem. There are some technical assumptions here. So phi is in L1. So x times 1 minus x times derivative of y, derivative phi must also be in L1. It means that at endpoints we can have unbounded behavior, something which grows like L1 function, but in the middle it has to be smoother. We also assume that the integral of y is not zero. We assume that it is greater than zero, but if it is less than zero, you can just multiply everything by minus one. And there exists beta such that this condition is also satisfied. We assume that a is in cm plus one, and a at t and t is not equal zero. Since this operator is injective in the space of continuous functions, and the range of this operator is somewhere between cm plus 1 and cm. We can't exactly say what it is, but it is somewhere between here. And the inverse operator is continuous linear operator if we consider it from cm plus 1 to cm. And if the assumptions of the previous theorem is satisfied and f is in cm plus 1, then this equation is uniquely solvable in space of continuous functions, and its solutions is actually m times continuously differentiable. Now, polynomial collocation method for cordial integral equations. Actually, this polynomial collocation method is somehow very well suited for those cordial integral equations because if this a is constant, then t to some power, these are exactly eigenfunctions of those, of this operator. And if we have this function a present, then the eigenfunctions still behave similar to t to some power. Okay, we choose collocation points and solve the collocation equations. And we need to calculate exactly or well enough those integrals, which are here. In the following, let E be equal to F, and it's the space of continuous functions. En is the space of polynomials of order up to n, and Zn is a linear span of delta functions. Let A be 1, then this operator V phi actually maps En to En. And tau n is simply the norm of the interpolation projector from C to C, interpolation with polynomials of order n with those interpolation nodes. And if we choose for those nodes, Chebyshev nodes, then Tn is known, it is following. We choose certain noise levels, and the noise was generated by random numbers with uniform distribution at the collocation nodes. And we also found, since we know the exact solution, we can find the optimal number, n optimal, and the corresponding optimal error. And we used this modified discrepancy principle to find the corresponding n. And for bn, we used this value, so 0.001 times 1 plus tau n. And the results are given in the concrete equation first. We consider this kind of cordial integral equation. Here, this phi is equal to 1 over square root of x. exact solution is known, it is this. So right now this F is analytic and this exact solution is also analytic. Kappa n can be estimated using Markov's equality. It is some constant times n squared. And since the right-hand side of the equation is analytic, then this distance from F to AEn actually converges to zero exponentially. Hence, all the assumptions of theorem 8 are satisfied. We took this T to be equal to 10 and noisy data with different noise levels. And the number of collocation nodes was like this. And then the results are here. So we have different delta levels here. We have optimal errors and optimal n's. And these are the errors given by the discrepancy principle and n given by the discrepancy principle. And this is a b we used in the discrepancy principle. So this b now grows with n. And we see that the errors are, well, basically the same, a little bit higher here, but not much different, I think up to 2 times more. And actually this n given by discrepancy principle is smaller than n optimal. So we have actually less effort to get those errors, and errors are not too much different. Another example, equation with the same kernel, but with different right-hand side, so it is not so smooth now. Exact solution is like this. So kappa n is still c n squared. And the distance from f to an, a e n can be estimated by c times 1 over n cubed. And the assumptions of the theorem are again satisfied. Again, we used noisy data with some noise levels. Noise was generated as before. And the results are here. So again, optimal errors are here, and errors obtained by this discrepancy principle are here. They are not very different. But in this case, for some reason, this n given by discrepancy principle is actually generally bigger than n here. I don't know why. So the example was quite similar. And I have one more example, spline collocation for Volterra integral equation. So we consider this operator, integral operator, acting from LP to C. We use space of discontinuous piecewise polynomials for En of order k minus 1, and we find Un such that the collocation equations are satisfied at points Tij, which are obtained this way. So we first divide our interval into a uniform mesh, and inside each small interval, we choose some collocation parameters to get these collocation points. Now this kappa n brief can be estimated by using theorem 6 we had before, this estimate. So this is this norm of identity operator from fn to wn. And it depends on how much this operator A is mousing. And I have one very simple example here where the kernel is just 1. The right-hand side is t to q over q. Exact solution is then s to q minus 1. We use discontinuous linear splines with uniform mesh. And collocation points are like this. So we have the right endpoint of the interval and something inside here that we don't want to specify at first. For Fn, we took the space of continuous linear splines, and the inverse property of splines then gives us the estimate for kappa n prime as c times n. The distance from F to A en can be estimated by C times n to minus Q. Q was taken here 3 over 2 and 5 over 2. And it can be shown that tau is equal to this one, and it actually does not depend on n at all. Since tau is minimal for C equals 1/2, then we use this C equals 1/2, and this tau is then 1.25. So we took P as follows, and again noisy data with different noise levels, and the results are here. So this part is for Q equals 3/2, and this is for Q equals 5/2. And again, the results are not so much different for optimal errors and for errors obtained from this discrepancy principle. But n obtained from the discrepancy principle is in some case quite a bit larger. And it is actually more pronounced here if Q is smaller. So if we have less smoothness, it seems that this discrepancy principle tends to choose too large n. And this is basically it. This is some literature. I only put up literature that I directly used in this talk. So, thank you for attention.